Darryl, would you like to get us started?
Will do.
Thanks, Ryan. Good evening, everyone. In the interest of safety, we are wearing masks, but I'm going to take mine off while I'm speaking so I don't hyperventilate and pass out off this tall chair. No, I'm just kidding. We're all fully vaccinated and we're spaced apart, but when we're not speaking, we will be masked up. So I just want everyone to be aware of that. So as Ryan said, thank you again for dialing in on your evening to share this with us. As a public hospital district, you know, it's very important to us that we are transparent in what we're doing. And so I'm glad that some of you are able to join us. And as Ryan said, I know we have some questions in advance. We're going to address those as we go through. And towards the end, we'll open it up and be able to dialogue a little bit more freely. So I want to thank Ryan for all his help. And I want to thank the commissioners for joining us this evening. And Jennifer for all her help. They are our strategic planning committee. We meet regularly throughout the year. So while the strategic planning process doesn't happen every year, we're always working on it and looking for ways to make it better and refine it. So appreciate all their efforts over the years. The first thing I wanted to talk about pretty quickly is I want to talk about our existing strategic plan. And the main reason is because a lot of the things that are in that plan we have accomplished, and I'm pretty proud of those. It's taken all 1,650 or so of us here at OMC to make these things happen. But despite the massive distraction of a pandemic, we still got a lot of other things done that were in the plan, and I think it served us well. So I'm going to highlight a few of those things. The first thing I want to talk about is the completion of our Olympic our Cancer Center expansion in SQIM. We added medical oncology capacity space there. And we also added a larger pharmacy for chemotherapy, and that was about a $5 million project that wrapped up earlier this year. It was delayed because of the pandemic, but we did get that one done. Currently, we're actually looking to add a second linear accelerator at the Cancer Center in SQIM also, which is an ongoing project, but again, something that we laid out a few years ago and is moving forward. I'm going to talk briefly about our central sterile processing remodel. In essence, that was the basement of the old hospital part of the main hospital building, I should say. That was a massive effort. It took many phases. As somebody put it once, and I think it was an appropriate description, it was kind of like driving your car and changing the tire without stopping. You know, we do run 24/7, and these services in the basement around central sterile processing, which we do for all of our clinics and our OR and our ED, they're constantly providing sterilization services to all those areas. So we couldn't stop running and had to do that project over a series of phases. Really complicated, hopefully a once-in-a-career project, but we got that one done as well. And that was another multi-million-dollar project that we were able to successfully complete through the last 18 months. I want to talk about our decrease in opioid prescription rates, which are down 33% as of the end of 2020. That was a stated goal in our strategic plan, and that's another area where we made a lot of progress. We made huge improvements in our call centers, and our wait times have dropped dramatically, and that has increased actually our patient access and our ability for patients to be triaged through the call center system. That was a variety of some technological improvements, but a lot of effort from our call center staff and working closely with our clinics for better workflows. So that was another area of huge improvement that I believe for the public calling in. I hope you've noticed that in your work with OMC. We've did some really focused planning on our cancer center. I highlighted a couple of projects, but in addition to that, looked at operational improvements in leadership structure, staffing, and workflows throughout our cancer center that have been very productive and successful. We also went through a pretty significant transformation in our primary care clinics. That was another area of really focused work by many, many people over about a year-long process. And I think our primary care practice is moving in a great new direction. We've met our net income target goal of 2%. While that's not a large number, the 2% in our strategic plan, which is our net income goal, is enough for us to pay the principal on our debt, continue to invest in our infrastructure and medical equipment, and able to keep wages up with the market. So that's important for us, but that's another goal that we have hit. And lastly, we did hit our cash reserve target of 90 days cash on hand. Now, if you're not a finance nerd like I am, basically what that means is, you know, if we just stopped getting paid tomorrow, we'd have enough money to live on for about 90 days, which is not a bad position to be in, but it's a prudent business and a good goal for us to have that we've accomplished. So those are some successes of the current plan, but I also want to talk a minute about the current environment. I know you all are well aware of the pandemic, and the pandemic has changed things for all of us. I know, but here at OMC, what it's really brought to us is the fact that more people in our community are in crisis than ever before. And that's in a variety of ways. But these people are in our emergency room, they're in our clinics, they're on the floors here in the hospital, and they need our services. And we have as many as 12 people in the house in the hospital at a time that are hard to discharge or hard to move to the right setting for their care. There's a variety of reasons for this, but some of the main challenges that we see are substance abuse, mental health conditions, and dementia, you know, late dementia, where there's no support system for these folks. And they know OMC is a safe place, and a lot of these people end up here under our care. And it's important to us to take good care of them, but that is something that has become more acute here in the last year or so. And as the pandemic winds down, we expect that to continue. There's a new focus across our country on equity, diversity, and inclusion. That is also a new piece of our strategic plan that we'll be looking at more intently. Be more on that in a little bit. Telehealth and remote care needs. As we've gone through the pandemic, we've really had to accelerate a lot of the things like we're doing here with this conference room. And we've had to learn how to use things called Zoom that I'd never heard of a year ago, Microsoft Teams, and other things in our normal work. But that said, on the patient care front, patients also have learned ways to communicate with their providers, nurses, and others. Telehealth and remote care, I'll call it, is a new focus of ours, and something that we're not alone in this, but something nationwide that all health systems are working with. Some things that haven't changed, but continue to be a focus. You know, OMC is still paid below cost for Medicare and Medicaid. That is still something that we have to fight for. We work very hard with our folks in Olympia and in Congress to make sure that as a sole community hospital in Collin County, we're not forgotten about. The reimbursement that we receive is important to all of us. So that continues to be a challenge of ours. And workforce is a significant challenge. And I'll let Jennifer talk a little bit more about that. But we have a lot of open positions with our just to take care of the current landscape that we have here in Port Angeles and Sequim, and our workforce efforts continue to be a big piece of what we do and another piece of our kind of the current environment that we're dealing with. I want to take just a couple of minutes to talk about the major themes to the revision of the strategic plan, and so some of those I've highlighted a moment ago. We talked about diversity, equity, and inclusion. We'll be weaving those concepts into the plan. An increased focus on mental and behavioral health in our community and how we can treat them here and better at OMC. Workforce is another focus. And reimbursement is another focus. We're a tweener hospital. We're not paid at costs like a small critical access, but we don't necessarily have the critical mass of a large urban center or some of the larger systems that you've seen consolidate across the nation. We're kind of in the middle. So it's important for us to make sure we advocate for ourselves and be sure that we're not forgotten about in Congress and in Olympia. All of the things I mentioned are gonna require work with our community partners across Collin County and in the I-5 corridor. It's going to require out-of-the-box approaches for us here internally at OMC. How do we stretch our resources a bit further? How do we do the best we can with the resources that we've got? And again, advocacy at the state and federal level is going to be another approach to dealing with these problems. There's also two other initiatives that we have launched that go along with our strategic planning process. One of them is a medical staff development plan. The goal of the medical staff development plan is to help us understand the demographics of our community and the region to make sure that we have the right providers for all of you. And that could be, how many primary care providers should OMC have? How many primary care providers should Known have? North Limbic Healthcare Network, how many should the community have? How many urologists should we have? This will give us some new statistical information to use for our recruiting efforts and help us know where we need to hire our own versus where do we work with our partners like Swedish to help us augment the services that we have here and maybe bring specialists out of the area that can help us, kind of bridge those gaps where we don't necessarily have enough volume to hire our own bench of providers. So the other initiative is a hospital planning exercise that's going to launch here soon. The main hospital building, parts of it are 70 years old. We've done a great job maintaining it in those 70 years, and I think it has a lot more life in it. We've added to it many times, but what we've done is we've added bits and pieces here and there. We really need more beds. Our inpatient bed count is 67. We'd like to look at probably 85 beds. There are times where we just don't have enough beds. There's times when it's not that the house is full and we're overflowing, but maybe we don't have enough labor and delivery beds. Maybe we don't have enough medical surgical beds for people coming out of surgery. Sometimes we don't have enough ICU beds. So we are undergoing a process to look more completely at our hospital building. And that will also include surgical services for our operating rooms and our short stay area where we do the pre and post-op work as well. So those are two other initiatives that will also be shaping the plan in the coming months that I wanted to share. Briefly, the process of all this, we are not redoing the strategic plan and starting over. The strategic plan we're working with now was designed to go from 2019 to 2022. But as I mentioned, the world has changed quite a bit. We've got some things done. That said, we need to tweak it and we need to revise it a little bit. I would say 75 or 80% of the plan that we have is awesome and what we want and is continuing to move us forward in a great way. But there are some things that we would like to adjust. So it's not a complete tear it down and start over. And then this current plan has served us really well through the pandemic. I think if you distill it down and you just look at our mission, vision, and values, that has led us a long way through the pandemic as we've worked with other entities, as we've kind of banded together here amongst ourselves. Just living those values every day has helped us a great deal. We're going to have a series of forums like this. This is the second public forum. We're having a series of forums with our employees. We're going to be having a forum with a medical staff, a forum with invitations specifically to some community leaders from Port Angeles and SQIM. So there's going to be a lot more dialogue around this in the coming month or so. But our goal is to have a new revised plan issued in August of 2021. So that's kind of the general concept. So I want to take just a minute here and talk about a couple of questions that I want to answer before I turn it over to Jennifer that did come in advance of this time. One question came in around our site neutral, the regulations in site neutral that many of you are aware of. And this was the 60% reimbursement cut that we took at all hospital outpatient facilities that are not within 250 yards of the main hospital. So that's a mouthful, but basically what that means is that's our SQIM campus and that's two of our larger clinics here in Port Angeles. Here in Port Angeles, we had a pretty good ability to kind of move people around. It was very disruptive, but because the cuts only took place in the Medicare population, we had to move a lot of our primary care providers into their new medical office building just across from the hospital. But pretty disruptive. We made some moves with our pediatrics clinic and also made some moves with our women's health clinic. So pretty disruptive in Port Angeles, but we've been able to mitigate a lot of those cuts by relocating folks, despite how painful that was. SQIM is a little bit different. Obviously, SQIM is 16 miles away from us. We've spent tens of millions of dollars over the year developing the beautiful campus that we have there. But that said, you know, we are probably losing about $1.5 million on the swim side of the district, you know, versus what we were losing a few years ago. That said, we are making no changes. So I want to make that clear. So the cuts have been disruptive. They have resulted in losses, but we're committed to swim and we'll continue to be. Which leads me to the second question that has come in from a few people, which is about, you know, what are your plans in swim? As I just said, we plan to maintain all services in swim. As I mentioned earlier, we're on an incremental growth strategy in swim. We're adding to the cancer center. We're also currently adding to primary care in a small way, despite these cuts. We had a grand vision, which I personally worked on for a few years in the past before I was in this job. And with those site neutral changes that I mentioned, that unfortunately made that a lot less viable for us. That said, we do continue to make incremental changes there to meet the community's needs. Another question along these lines has been around emergency services and SQUIM. Right now, you know, I think the key to our growth in SQUIM is something we need to make incremental, sustainable changes in SQUIM. And a new ED is something that is a significant undertaking that is more of a long-range plan. I think it's something that will warrant more discussions. I know there's a lot of questions about that. But I think what we have to think about when you think of an emergency room is what it takes to run one. Even if it's not 24/7, it's 16 hours a day. When you think of the diagnostics that are needed in terms of lab, in terms of imaging, in terms of on-call providers, in terms of staffing, I mean, Jennifer's going to talk a little bit about workforce. We have 200 open positions right now that we're trying to fill, and a lot of those are critical clinical staff. You know, so there's a lot to having a major new service line in SQUIM. That's not to say it won't ever happen, but it is to say that in the short term, we really want to be expanding the services we currently have. We have a walk-in clinic there. There may be some opportunity there that we can sort of slowly absorb these cuts because, unfortunately, you know, there's not a lot more money coming in to do all these things at this time. So, you know, I would like to look at the feasibility of something in SQUIM. I am going to actually look at, because I, to be honest, we need to see what's possible from a regulatory perspective. At one time, I think someone talked about putting another hospital in SQUIM. The regulations don't allow that because of proximity to Jefferson Healthcare and OMC. So anyway, so I want to address that. I assume there'll be more questions about that one. And I look forward to more discussions because it's really complicated. But I want everyone to know that's on this call from SQUIM, we're dedicated to SQUIM. It's not something we've forgotten about, that we don't care about, but we are looking at more of an incremental strategy to try to meet your needs. And that's kind of the end of the questions. I will pause there for just a second and see if there's any questions on the chat at this point, Ryan.
Yeah, there's one question that is the court fight against the Medicare cut still in progress or has it been finalized?
Mm-hmm. Do you want to take that one?
Sure, I'd be glad to. The court case, and good evening, everyone. I'm Jennifer Burkhardt.
Yeah, sorry to cut you there. Yeah.
CHRO and General Counsel, and welcome. We're so glad to have you on the call. The site-neutral battle continues in the court. Where it is presently is we have a petition filed with the United States Supreme Court, a petition for certiorari, which asks for review by the highest court in the land. And that court is considering the petition now. It's been opposed by the government, which would like to have an affirmation of the appellate ruling. The Court of Appeals had ruled against us after we had an initial favorable ruling in the trial court. So we continue to battle that. We hope to hear from the United States Supreme Court sometime this summer, and we will keep the community apprised of the developments, and just want to thank the community and everyone for the support that was shown to us throughout that site-neutral battle and continuing today.
Yeah. All right. Thanks, Jennifer. So I want to talk a few minutes. Normally, also on our strategic planning is Lorraine Cannon, our chief financial officer. Normally, she does this part. She could not be here tonight, so I'm going to take a couple minutes about financial stewardship, and then I'm going to turn it over to Jennifer. You know, financial stewardship is one of our core values. It's also central to all to our plan and a lot of what we do here, obviously. It's also key to OMC remaining locally owned and controlled. You know, we feel that the best healthcare decisions for Collin County should be made here. If we were part of a large system, they may be made in Denver, they may be made in Texas, they may be made in pick a place. But being locally owned and controlled is something that the board is passionate about, is something we're passionate about, and is something that we will fight for. And that is part of why our financial stewardship is so important to us and why we're so focused on that. So there's a few things, there's a few metrics in the strategic plan that I'll talk about. One of them is the net income goal. I mentioned previously we've been meeting the 2% net income goal. I'm going to be recommending and talking with the committee about increasing that to a 3% goal. I think that will continue to help us build our reserves maybe a little bit more over time, but again, keeps us in good stead, I think, from a financial strength perspective. The other one is the days cash on hand a metric I mentioned, which is we hit 90 days. I think we're going to be looking at pushing that to 100 days, which will continue to grow our reserves a little bit more. But a key piece of our operations is maintaining a low debt position. We have a stated goal in the strategic plan of 33% debt to equity, and kind of basically what that means is, if you have a $200,000 house, let's say, or a $200,000 mortgage, and you owe $60,000, that means it's about 30%. So it's kind of like OMC has a mortgage that's that much, and basically 70% of it we own, 30% of it we owe on, which is actually a pretty good position to be in for a hospital and an organization our size. But having low debt, a good cash position, and a reasonable bottom line, sustainable over time, is how we're going to make it. So those are a couple of tweaks that we'll be making to the new plan as well. And with that, I will turn it over to Jennifer.
Great. Thank you, Darryl. And thank you, everyone, again, for being here tonight. One comment I would add regarding that great question on site neutral is that the court case is not the only avenue we have for a remedy there. It's so important to us if we can get those payments restored for site neutral that we have been advocating in every arena possible. So Congressman Derek Kilmer has been extremely supportive throughout the process, and he introduced legislation in the last session at the federal level called the PLACE Act, Protecting Local Access to Care Everywhere, good acronym there. It passed the House, it did not pass the Senate, but he indicated that with the change in administration that we've just seen this past fall, he would be reintroducing the PLACE Act legislation and also arranging for a meeting with the new head of the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services, CMS. And that is an appointed position by the administration. So now that there's a new head of CMS, there is the possibility that we would see some relief by regulation, by rule, and or through the legislative process. So we are pursuing that avidly at every level that we possibly can. If we can get those payments reinstated, it will really help us in terms of expansion and help our community in a number of ways. So just a couple of the specific goals that I'll touch on tonight. One of the goals, Darryl referenced that we are including a specific reference to diversity, equity, and inclusion in our strategic plan going forward. This is not necessarily a new concept. In fact, OMC has been here for 70 years now, and these are part of our long-held values and beliefs. Most of you know our mission is to serve the community and to do so with excellence in healthcare together, and we rely on our seven values of quality, safety, teamwork, respect, compassion, integrity, and stewardship, and those are all based on principles of diversity and inclusion. However, in talking to our Board of Commissioners, there is a strong commitment to taking this to the next level, and by that we mean really elevating specifically the concept of equity in our strategic plan and incorporating a specific goal. That goal will have several elements, one of which is to work with a third party, the Cross-Cultural Healthcare Program, which is an entity that has helped several healthcare organizations in Washington to achieve goals in the arena of diversity and equity. So we'll be working with them to accomplish specific strategies. We're also working with our frontline staff, which is really exciting. We have an equity and inclusion committee and some staff who are very excited about moving forward with these concepts. And then we're also leveraging state and national resources. We have just signed on to an 18-month Washington State Hospital Association Health Equity Collaborative, and they're helping put us in touch with some national resources as well. So we're really excited about the opportunities that present themselves in this area, and we want to continue to build on our long-held values and beliefs and make those even more explicit in our organization, both as to employees in the staff arena, and then also with regard to our treatment in healthcare services for our patients, so in both areas. The second goal that I'll touch on briefly is workforce, and Darryl alluded to the fact that we have a growing number of employees. We have 1,637 employees, so even though we faced a pandemic this last year, we did still add to our staff. We added about 50 employees in the last year, and the previous 5 years, we had been adding about 100 employees per year, so we continue to grow. We're the largest employer in Clallam County, and we took that responsibility very seriously, even at the outset of the pandemic when we were not sure how finances would play out in the middle of a crisis. But we didn't engage in layoffs. We did not cut salaries. We didn't ask employees to take furloughs or engage in any other measures that would have harmed our employees. And we're looking back very glad that we were able to do that. We kept our workforce whole and, in fact, added staff. That being said, with a strong workforce, we do have a lot of open positions. There's a national workforce shortage, and we're not immune from that. So we have 201 open positions. That means that we're actively engaged in developing new strategies, participating in both virtual and traditional job fairs, really utilizing new technology platforms, and frankly, being as creative as we possibly can. Even though we have these workforce shortages and we're facing them, it's been a good narrative that we've been able to share with candidates as we've brought them in. So we currently have over 113 providers, and we've been adding providers at a remarkable clip, in part because other healthcare organizations did cut salaries, and there were measures taken across the country in many hospitals that we didn't have to take. So we were able to share our story of adding staff, of having a high level of retention. We have better than the national average in retention. We didn't freeze hiring, we didn't freeze salaries and the like. So that's something that's been appealing, and we've been able to continue to develop our staff numbers through that process. That being said, we do have workforce development within our workforce because we have such difficulty attracting enough workers for our open positions. So we're looking to develop within and building career ladders, which is a strong focus for us. It's been in our strategic plan previously and will continue to be in our strategic plan. Just for reference, in 2020, OMC filled 693 open positions. Interestingly enough, 357 of those were filled by internal candidates, meaning that they were moving through these career ladders and offered promotions, internal movement, career development, and the like. So that's something that we will continue to do. We did have 336 positions filled by external candidates, so brought in a number of external candidates as well. With regard to the workforce development, we continue to work with Peninsula College, which is also part of our strategic plan, to work with our community partners. We added training spots to the registered nurse program, as well as the certified nurse assistant and medical assistant programs. In concert with our local legislators, we were able to get a budget proviso and worked with Peninsula College to make those programs more robust and offer more training seats. And we're very much looking forward to hiring graduates from those various programs. In fact, this next year, we are hoping to hire 25 new graduate registered nurses. And we have 25 of those positions posted now. We have 54 open positions for registered nurses. So it is, like many other hard-to-fill positions, an area where we're actively recruiting. For CNAs and also MAs, we offer reimbursement and on-the-job trainings. We have a medical assisting apprenticeship program. And for CNAs, we're offering many of our entry-level positions reimbursement for 100% of tuition fees and books through Peninsula College's CNA program. So we're really encouraging employees in entry-level positions to continue to go through career ladder steps. And then implementing in-house training programs for jobs such as surgical techs. We offer tuition reimbursement to support those who have educational goals that match our workforce needs. Just really doing everything that we can to continue to augment our workforce. Another goal that I'll reference quickly is patient experience, which has been a key focus for us this past year. Of course, during a pandemic, there were impacts on many in our community. There were really deep impacts on our patients, especially as we, in some cases, had to constrain the number of visitors who were able to come into our building because of the pandemic. So a key focus for patient experience has been adding staff so that we could be sure to provide communication between patients and their loved ones, and really trying to communicate that we're patient-centered in all we do, enhancing the employee-to-patient communication and courtesy, trying to decrease wait times for our services, and then implementing a particular initiative around age-friendly because of the demographics that we have in Clallam County. We have more in the elderly and vulnerable patient population than other counties in terms of our service. So we're actively working on strategies to really serve our patients well. And with regard to our emergency department, we're trying actively to reduce those wait times and admission times left without being seen averages, and really employing other strategies to try to work with the community to meet the needs. The last item I'll check on, touch on is behavioral health, and we have seen in our community, to no one's surprise, I don't think, an increase in, unfortunately, behavioral health, mental health crises, and substance abuse disorders, and that's something that is really reflected in our emergency department and often in our inpatient admissions as well as in our clinics. So we do consider this to be a crisis, and we're actively working with community partners. Some of those are Peninsula Behavioral Health, Rediscovery. We're actively meeting with law enforcement, and we're working on things such as staff training for de-escalation, really trying to employ best practices in the treatment of behavioral health patients. It's a tough area, but it's one of our main strategic plan goals to work through in every way that we can, partnering with state, national resources, as well as our community partners to address what's become a burgeoning problem in Clallam County. So we look forward to more community info. We're so glad that all of you are here with us tonight. And I think at this point, we'll open it up for questions. I'll turn it back to Darryl.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Go ahead, Brian.
Yeah, we're going to move to the open Q&A portion of tonight's forum in just a minute. You're going to have a option to turn on your camera if you'd like, and the option to unmute yourself and dialogue directly with our panelists. We ask that you please keep your mic muted unless you're making a comment or asking a question. If you have a question or comment, please raise your hand. Whether you're on camera, you can actually raise your hand or do it virtually by navigating to the participants panel in the lower right of the screen and clicking on the hand icon, or you can just put your name or question in the chat. If you happen to be joined by phone, you can dial *3 to raise your hand. So now you should have the option to turn on your camera if you'd like to unmute yourself and ask a question or raise your hand and make a comment. So if you have any questions or comments, please let us know. One question that came in prior to the forum is about a ear, nose, and throat specialist on the North Olympic Peninsula, and if there's a chance of adding one of those.
Sure. Yeah, no, that's a great question, and I think that's kind of goes back to that medical staff plan that we are working on, which will actually be done this summer. That's one area where Dr. Craven did retire. That is an area where we have a gap. I think the question we're going to need to ask ourselves is, do we recruit? It's really hard to have a one person or a one doctor practice for the call responsibility and other things. So it'll be good for us to understand, you know, what are the needs of the community demographically, and then decide, you know, is that an area where we hire and recruit within, or do we maybe work with partners to bring people in weekly, monthly, quarterly, or something like that. So, but ear, nose, throat is one of those areas that, we have heard about. Rheumatology is another area that I've heard about. Endocrinology is another one I heard about. I've been asked about. And so, you know, all great questions, all specialists that we need in the area. The question is the method. And so I think that's why I'm really excited about this development plan to better help us understand. You know, we've made a couple of runs at, we tried endocrinology at one point, a halftime provider a couple of years ago. It just didn't really ever stick. You know, and so there's other avenues here rather than just us hiring. And I think the medical staff plan will help us understand where those are. And ear, nose, throat is one of those. So thank you for asking. And there'll be more to come on that.
Another question that came in prior to the forum is, are there any additional services that Dungeness Valley Health and Wellness Squim Free Clinic can provide to help with the emergency services budget?
Well, I think the free clinics perform a valuable service in terms of keeping people away from the ER, you know, when they're possibly in crisis or before they're in crisis. And so those efforts are recognized for sure by us. That's part of why we do contribute pretty significantly to both the Olympic Peninsula Clinic here, just west of the hospital, as well as the Dungeness Valley Clinic. So I'm not sure how to answer that question except to say, you know, thank you for everything that you do, and just know that the services you provide do help us a great deal. It's more, you know, preventative than anything. But so I guess maybe those are conversations that we could have. I think that's probably Sarah asking. Mm-hmm. And we can see if there's some, again, at this point, I think we all have budget shortfalls. We're all trying to figure out how to make the dollar stretch further. And so I'm up for being creative and figuring out better ways to work together. And if there's a way to help each other, then we should explore that. So it's kind of a non-answer, but I'm open to talk about it.
Amy, I see that you have your hand raised. We're going to unmute you, Amy, and you can ask your question.
Oh. Hi, Amy. We can see you. We lost you, Amy. Keep trying.
Is that better?
Yes. She's muted though.
How about that? How about that? Is that good?
How about that?
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Worth it. You were talking about the difficulty in recruiting. Is there any possibility of some kind of partnerships where providers would be able to have some place to practice temporarily, or are we short of facilities in Squim, for example, where they wouldn't be able to be housed anyway? I'm a little unclear on the challenges there.
I'll start. So I think in the provider realm, actually, we're doing pretty well with recruiting. We don't have a lot of open positions. What we do have currently, Amy, is we have a variety of folks from the I-5 corridor that do rotate through our Squim facilities. We have, you know, neurology is one I think that comes to mind, looking at a cardiologist to do the same. And what those providers generally are doing are things that we just don't do. They're more advanced level surgical things, and they're doing a lot of follow-ups on their patients here in Clallam County. Hmm. So I think the recruiting challenges we have, you know, when Jennifer talks about the 200 folks, The vast majority of those aren't providers. They're nurses, they're medical assistants, they're certified nursing assistants, they're sometimes IT people. But providers actually, as Jennifer mentioned, our COVID story is compelling, you know, in terms of how we've worked together across our community to deal with the pandemic, the fact we didn't lay people off. So we have, of those 200 positions that we have open, I think only about 10 of them are actually providers. So we've done pretty well on the provider front. So I think the question that, I think what you may be asking is you know, the type of specialties that we offer. And I think that's where we have to go back to that plan and see, you know, where do we actually hire our own team of ear, nose, throat specialists, for example, and where do we work with others, because there's just not enough of a market to have a bench of our own. Does that make sense?
Yes, thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you for the question. It's good to actually see you too. I can see your face and everything.
Ben, I see that we have a hand raised from you, so I'll go ahead and unmute you, Ben, and
you can ask your question. Okay, I'll try the video and see if it doesn't crash. There we go. So thank you. And my question is really, I know it's going to take further discussion. And again, it's focused on the SQIM campus. And I know it's a complicated issue, especially with the changes of the compensation formulas for that. But a couple things is, one is, you know, the goal one of your facilities talks about the SQIM campus master plan. And my first question is that going to get updated? And what's the process for that going to be? For updating the SQIM master plan, and kind of the related piece to that is, you discussed a little bit about the, you know, the 70-year-old main facility at Port Angeles and how it's been kind of added to. And my understanding is that there's, you know, an increased need for capacity, both in ER and in the floor. And at some point, I think you're going to run out of footprint to be able to build more on that facility. So has there been any discussion about not necessarily an additional hospital, but actually relocating a new facility in SQIM, similar to what Harrison did moving from Bremerton to Silverdale, where the numbers that I'm tracking are showing the population shift in Clallam County is moving to SQIM. And the last, since 2010, the growth rate in SQIM is double that of the rest of the county. So is that even on the radar for the long range planning that that the population in Clallam County, even though a lot of people aren't aware of it, is moving to SQIM, and the potential for either not necessarily an additional hospital, but a replacement hospital in SQIM?
Yeah, no, great question. No, that's okay. I'm glad you asked it, because the first one on the SQIM master plan is we completed a SQIM master plan in, I want to say, 2018 or 2019. And so the cancer center expansion was part of that we're working on now. And we're also, the primary care expansion that we had designed and the ambulatory surgery center that we had designed, those are part of that. We also looked at a larger, expansion of clinic space that was not yet defined. To the behind the current primary care physical therapy space out there. So as far as updating that, we have a pretty good vision for right now for what we're able to do. But I think at some point, yes, we'll need to do another master plan. But I think it's going to depend a lot on the regulatory side as far as what we can do in SQIM. So that's question one, I think, is, right now we have a plan that we're going to try to be building towards, and we're kind of working on that. The second question is, yes, even before I was in this job, when I was working with Eric, the board has been asking us to be looking for the next site. That's probably something that's after my career and our careers, perhaps, but because you're right. The current building has been well maintained, but it's not going to last forever. And you're right about the population. It is growing more on the east side of the county. And in a perfect world, we would locate 20 acres somewhere between Carlsberg and SQIM because of that. And so we're keeping our feelers out to try to look for that next location. because you're exactly right. And this place isn't going to last forever, and the population is moving that direction. So we are looking. So if you have any ideas, let me know. If you have 20 acres to sell with sewer and power, let me know. I'll put it that way.
Well, I do know that, like I said, I would look forward to you mentioned earlier having some additional meetings that are with more focused groups. And yeah. I think the EMS agencies would be one of the good groups. So just to kind of give you an idea, we have 4 medic units in SQUIM that cover 35,000 people, and it's 93 minutes average. Every time we transport somebody to the hospital, that medic is out of our response area. So we have a vested interest in, right, for Port Angeles, it's 4 minutes for Port Angeles Fire Department.
Right.
So that's kind of where we're looking at it as for servicing our community is that piece of it. So I'm looking forward to having more in-depth conversations at a more focused level.
Yeah. Thanks, Ben. And the other, as we move forward too, I mean, I would like to understand that better from you. And then is there a way we can help you with your service? And I don't know what that could look like, maybe with the city and others. I know in Port Angeles, you know, we've done some projects with them where we've helped support. So there may be some other avenues, because I know a lot of these plans are long range, but I know your needs are probably like right now. So with your 93 minutes, for example, you guys are probably doing that today. So, but if maybe there's something we can come up with and get creative in the coming, you know, year or two, and that might help to at least take the pressure off. I'm open to almost anything that we can afford and is reasonable. So thanks for the question.
Are there any other further questions or comments out there? All right. See any other questions?
Okay. The only thing I would offer is, I don't know if Anne-Marie wanted, did you want to make a comment as a member of the committee? It sounds like it's getting quiet. So I didn't know if you want to add anything.
Sure. I would add, I don't know if I heard either of you mention our focus on wellness and health in the strategic plan that we're working on now. And I'm pretty excited about that, especially with the CHIP program. I am pretty passionate about health and wellness as preventive. So the fact that our organization is looking at that and making that a priority is a gift for our employees and staff, but also for our community. And that's going to benefit everybody's health.
I'm glad you mentioned that, Anne-Marie. It also ties in to Sarah's question, I think, a little bit with regard to the Dungeness Valley Health and Wellness Clinic. Because Sarah's involved in a program that predated CHIP, which is the 5210 through the Olympic Peninsula Healthy Communities Coalition. And we're building on that with the CHIP program and really looking for community partners. And in fact, we've talked to OPHCC a little bit about the wellness program, because we do think that's the future of health, is really preventing chronic disease through lifestyle medicine. So it's something I think you're absolutely right, OMC is really devoted to, and hoping to work more with our community partners, including Dungeness Valley Health and Wellness Clinic, in the future.
Mm-hmm. Great. All right, thank you guys.
Just want to make sure everyone knows you can find more information about the current plan at olympicmedical.org/plan. If you have follow-up questions or comments after tonight's forum, you can email community@olympicmedical.org.
Okay.
All right.
Anything?
No further questions or comments. We'll wrap it up there. Thanks for joining us, everyone.
Yep.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Have a good night.
Appreciate you being with us.
Bye-bye. Thanks for the time.